today's edition of Inside Furman Basketball with head coach Bob Ritchie. We'll open today with an opening statement from coach, and then we'll get into the questions. Coach?
Well, I appreciate you being here today. Obviously, you know, more good than bad in these last couple weeks. I had some really, really good performances, specifically the two games at home. And I guess the last time we met was when we were about to head up to VMI, if I'm not mistaken. So we won three of the last four and, you know, didn't play as well as we wanted to on Saturday night. But a lot of that was credit to Wofford. I thought they played exceptional. And but we've overall made some progress. And as we've seen in the league, there's going to be a lot of unknowns. There's a lot of parity in the game right now. You can kind of see that in all leagues. And we just got to stay the course. We got to keep getting better. We've won 5 of 6. We got to continue to look at the things that have created the wins and then the things that have, you know, hurt us in the losses. And, you know, I think as we've gotten healthier, clearly we're a better team. I thought we reverted back a little bit in terms of our ball movement on Saturday night. I think you can see the 5-game winning streak. The ball moved really well. I thought we got really, really good shots. And subconsequently, we were able to feed that energy and that connection into our defense. And you saw our defense elevate to the top of the SoCon standings defensively until the last game. I think it's a funny thing. I've always said the game's complementary. When you don't play for one another on offense and the ball doesn't move as well, I think that also pushes a little bit of an isolated field defensively as well. And we didn't have that same connection, you know, on both ends. And, you know, the game, sometimes you look at it, offense, defense, scoring, you know, how good is it? It's all connected. And, you know, I think you look at the bookend games outside of the 5-game win streak, and you see basically two games on the road, which is something that we've got to continue to get better at, right? Dealing with hostile environments. You know, Chattanooga, great crowd. You know, Wofford, I'm sure it's the biggest crowd of the year for them. And, you know, those two crowds on the road, things aren't going our way. And then all of a sudden the ball sticks, quality of shot goes down, defense goes down, not a winning formula, right? And you look at the 5-game win streak, clearly 4 of them are at home, right? So you got the comforts of being in Timmins. And but even at VMI, you know, we defended well that night and, you know, held them. You know, they just scored almost 100 at Sanford, and we held them to 60 points. And, you know, I thought we did a good job on getting quality of look and making sure that we were connected defensively. So, you know, that's still a work in progress for us, finding consistency there. The good news is we have shown that we can do it, and we're going to keep working as hard as we can to do it more so consistently and, you know, trying to be connected on both ends. But happy overall with our progress, but clearly not a finished product yet.
Coach Carmine Jamay with Fox Carolina. I know you've been doing this a long time. How do you balance, you know, the win streak? Everything seems like it's going great. You know, JP hits the game winner, to losing to a rival. I know you spoke about it tactically, but emotionally, what do you tell the guys to ride the wave, the roller coaster of a season?
Yeah, the more you do it, great question. I mean, the more you do it, the faster you realize, especially in basketball. In football, you got the week. You know, basketball, you got 2 or 3 days. I think as I've looked back on my career, you know, the quicker you can get to the next game, the better you're going to be, you know. And I think sometimes winning, you know, I've always said this, losing hurts twice as bad as winning feels good, you know, which is the not so fun thing about this. I think when you win, you have that tendency to, oh man, this is great, celebrate, but then the next day, man, you're on to the next opponent, right? Because it's like, hey, we did what we came here to do. Sometimes when you lose, you can sit on that loss for a little while, right? And it can be a little moldy. And the temperament and the attitude and the spirit can all get affected by it. If it's still about, hey, you know what, we didn't play well here. Do just what you do, win or lose, okay? Why do we play well? What are things that we can do better? And I think that's the same thing in losing. Everything wasn't poor on Saturday night, but it wasn't good enough to win a game. And so what are the three things that, had we done that, we would have won the game? Well, let's go out there and practice them, and let's get better at them, and then let's figure out a way to go get a win at Citadel. And, you know, I think that just getting in that rhythm and routine of not letting the emotions linger either way. And, you know, people have asked me that, like, do you think it was a hangover? And, nah, absolutely not. Like, we had an incredible practice on Friday, you know. But, I mean, to be quite honest with you, we had a better practice Friday than we did Tuesday, the Sanford game. It just didn't translate to the court, you know, and I think you're seeing that in the country right now. I think, you know, Kansas, I think I heard 4-3 in the Big 12 for the first time in forever. I guess Tom would know.
Oh, yeah.
You know, you're seeing a lot of parity. Oregon State beats Arizona. I mean, you can go down the line, right? Like, just all the games of just the parity in college basketball right now, and momentum and energy are always going to be up for grabs. And you got to do what you can to prepare yourself for that game, but also, like, when you lose one, you got to move on quick, and when you win one, you got to move on quick.
I guess my question is, I wasn't obviously at the game, so it's hard for me to kind of gauge things, but, you know, I look at the two-point field goals, and a lot of people are focused on the threes, but when you only have, I think it's 7 2-point field goals in the entire game, that affects everything else. So it's inside out. But I think the game before, Chattanooga had 20 of 23 at one point inside the paint. Is that an indication, like you said, of the ball not moving? And if so, where is that breakdown happening when it's not moving?
Yeah, I think it was a combination of two things. You're exactly right. I mean, they got the ball in the paint all night, and we didn't. And, you know, that was the big key to the game, obviously. And I think some of it is our ball movement, our cutting, our spacing, for sure. I think some of it's just aggression. You know what I mean? I think some of it's just players just being aggressive and really looking to attack closeouts and playing on two, getting off the ball and getting to the next. You know, they were clearly trying to load up to the ball, and that's what Wofford's always done to us. You know, it wasn't different than how they typically play defense. But you have to, if they're going to shrink the floor and they're going to really come in there and they're going to raid gaps, you got to get it out, and the next guy's got to be ready to attack, and you got to get them in a little bit of a spin cycle. But if you don't, then they can just plug those gaps and keep that paint restricted, and the ball doesn't move quite freely enough. Guys are taking tough ones. And then all of a sudden now we're not being aggressive. We need to be aggressive to really play for one another. That's when all of a sudden now the rim does feel restricted, you know, and we had some tough finishes around the rim. And, you know, it's one of those situations. I think, you know, JP and Mark went, I think, 2 for 12 from two combined. And, you know, we got to be better there, right? We got to be better getting to the basket and being efficient at the basket, being efficient from two. But you got to cut them. You got to move them. You got to get the ball side to side. You can't just go down there and try to get one attack and try to go score. That's never been really a good formula for us, and to be honest with you, John, for anybody, you know.
Coach, 22-9 at one point. You were 1 for 9, 0-5 from three-point range, but you got it together a little bit in the first half and got within two at 31-29. And then the final minute, 30 in the first half, was kind of a tough one. It kind of changed to certain things as you went into halftime.
Yeah, I thought we had two moments, you know, of striking distance where, you know, cut it to 31-29, like you referenced right there. And then we had another time with about 11 minutes to go in the game. We cut it to 5. And, you know, they made runs both times. And, again, you got to give them credit for that. But, you know, turnovers were critical in that run before half, transition defense, and, you know, giving them baskets around the rim, I thought. And then we took another bad shot right there before half. You know, you just – when you're playing in somebody else's gym and they've got a close to capacity crowd, students are there, you know, they're all like, you got to go play clean. You know, at the end of the day, you got to play clean. And, you know, it's a hard place to win. They've only lost one game there all year. You know, heck, we've won two games there since 2011, I think, and it's been the past 2 years. And, you know, the reason we were able to go over there and win is because we went and played clean. You know, we went and played clean, and the ball was moving, and ball was spaced, and we were working together. And you know, 2 years ago we went in there and really defended them. Last year we went in there and really scored the ball well. But this year, you know, for whatever reason, it just seemed like we reverted back, and we didn't quite have the connection amongst our group that we need to have. We're a really, really good team when we play for one another. I'm talking really good, and I'm talking like we get, because you just put a lot of attackers out there. You know, you just put a lot of guys that can drill pass shoot out there and get them playing off one another. And like, I don't know, it's the Emerson quote, huh? Like, you know, it's amazing what you can accomplish when nobody cares who gets the credit. Like, when we get a group that's just bought in the winning and moving the ball and cutting and playing for one another, I don't know how you you stop us, right? But when it becomes predictable and we're not letting, we're not moving the defense enough, and we're not getting the advantages that we need to get, and we're taking shots before we've really made the defense work, that's when it gets a little difficult. And, you know, but we've, like I said, we've got, especially in the last six games, we got a lot more film of doing it right than doing it wrong. And, you know, did go our way on Saturday, but that didn't take away what we did do for five games. And the challenge for us is just to get back on track there.
Coach, how's the overall health of the team going into the game at Citadel?
I think we're pretty good. You know, we'll have one that doesn't practice today. You know, so we're not full per se, but we're a lot better than what we were. And you know, it's getting better. And you know, it's something that it's yeah, it's nice to have our guys at least available and ready to go. And you know, it's been good to be able to have some continuity with practice as well. So we're for this time of year, we're getting to relatively healthy.
Coach, I know it probably seems like a lifetime ago with everything that's happened now, but as far as 150 wins, what does that represent for you in the program?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, when you talk about 150 wins, you know, right now, I think that shows program, you know, it shows consistency of winning, and that's a credit to a lot more people than myself, right? And I think back, you know, the things that make you the proud of what we've been able to accomplish here. One, getting over the hump and getting the program to the NCAA tournament, but also secondly, having sustainable winning. And I think that's really hard to do in this day and age, you know, when you look at the sustainability of it. And usually that's been because the ability to retain and the ability to continue to have a winning culture in place, identity in place that allows you to say, this is who we are, this is how we play, this is what we recruit to, and get a group and an organization to buy into, hey, this is how we have to do it. I think that people have to understand that, like, that's a lot bigger than me, right? Like, I get to lead it, but to get everybody to buy into that, that's a credit to a lot of players, that's a credit to a lot of staff, that's a credit to administration, that's a credit to a board. We've been able to do this together. And you look at the pictures behind you right here of the facility. You look what we've been able to do with the tournament last year. You look at the last three home games and just the consistency of crowd and environment. And, you know, it's a lot of checkoffs of what people said could never be done here. And, you know, I think when you get in moments, you got to pull the lens back a little bit and you got to look at it and say, you know what, 10 years ago, I mean, I think they were giving away free food just to get people in the door. Mm-hmm. And, system. I think we won 7, 8, 9 games. I mean, but to see what a group of people have decided to carry out a vision of, this is what we can be, this is what we can do here, right? And this is how we're going to do it. We're going to kind of have our way and our identity. I think that's what gives you the most pride about it. You know, but it's never going to be about me. This is about the program. And I'm just, like I said, I'm thankful and humble that, you know, God gave me the ability and, you know, just the blessing to be able to do something I love to do every single day. So hopefully there's a lot more to come. And, you know, we love what we're doing here at Furman. We love what we're building here at Furman. We don't think we're done. We think there's more to do. And, you know, we're excited about what's ahead.
I think one of the positives probably from Saturday was a play of Davis Molnar. Comes in. I think he provided a couple steals and some energy that maybe you were lacking previously in the game. And then also, how important is it to just focus, this team has won 5 of 6, and on the positive side of it, going to the Citadel, a place that it's tough to play, and they got a win over you guys last year. Just talk about those two games.
Yeah, I thought Davis was great in the game. And, you know, I thought he gave us some physicality down there. And, you know, it's one of those things where we're not getting the production out of the 5 spot that we need to, you know, in terms of where we want to go. And I think that, you know, we were getting physically moved around down there too easily, and we had to find somebody else that was going to come in there and at least battle, you know, just from a physicality standpoint. I think that Garrett and Tyrese would both tell you that, you know, they both know they needed to play better, decisions on, hey, do I think they can get there? You know, do I feel like me? I think that's one of the biggest things, you know, for us to get the best, we've got to get consistency at the five spot, right? Like, who's it going to be, right? Who's it going to be? And I don't mind saying this publicly. The team knows this. I mean, based on experience, based on moments, based on reps, needs to be Garrett. You know, I mean, I'm not hiding behind that, and I don't. That's what I want. That's what I wanted from day one. That's who started the first couple games. That's who started the first lot of games. I think Garrett has to understand that he's got to be physical. He's got to be confident, right? This game requires swagger, you know. It requires confidence. Garrett's a really good player, and I said it after the Sanford game. But he's got to go do it. You know, he's got to go do it. He's got to embrace the physicality of the game and not get so down on himself, but just go play, right? And, you know, I got frustrated with him in that play, you know, before half and transition where he didn't run back. And I thought, you know, the turnover and some of the inside play, we got to be better. And, you know, Tyrese played probably a little bit better than I thought on film. You know, he played, he gave us a little bit more physicality. But I just thought we needed a spark. You know, it was one of those games where, I mean, obviously things weren't going great. And I thought PJ, I thought Ben, I thought Davis provided some of that energy for us. But we've got it. I mean, listen, when you're trying to win a championship and you're trying to compete at the top of the league and stay in contention, your guys got to be guys. And like, at the end of the day, like, the people that you know have experience doing it. I mean, Garrett started on one of the best teams in school history. Right, like, sure, there were two pros around him, and that probably, and he played alongside a guy that got drafted in the NBA. I'm sure that gave him some confidence, but you know, that's part of what we've been able to build here too. Is next man up, you know, like, hey, it's your turn, it's your time, and we brought him off the bench, but that doesn't mean I have any less faith or trust in him. Right, out of halftime at Sanford, we started him second half and played a ton of minutes, and he was plus 22. You know, like, I'm not trying to hold it back out there. Like, you want to go be plus 22, you go play the whole game. You know, like, I'm good with it. But there's got to be some responsibility in this, of not even necessarily his production, but just how physical, the spirit, the leadership. He's a beautiful person. He is. Garrett is an unbelievable human being. And I want to see him look back on this hard moment. I want him to be able to look back tangibly and say, you know what, I really matured there. Like, I really started to accept responsibility for my consistency and my effort and my swagger and my confidence and my ability to affect winning. And you know what? Like, there's time left. You know what I mean? And whoever it's going to be, if it's going to be Garrett, if it's going to be Tyrese, if it's going to be Cooper, if it's going to be Davis, we've got to anchor in. I think we've anchored in pretty much at the other four spots. Consistency there. We've got to find consistency at the five spot.
Coach, the Sibyls 1-7 at home, then wins over Mercer, and Mercer goes in, wins at USCG. So despite the fact that the record's not all that good, you won 82-68 here. You know what happened last year, 69-65. So going on the road to the Southern Conference, and you know how they can play at home, it'll be a tough ball game for you, I would imagine.
Yeah, I mean, if the way we played Saturday, if we don't come out with an edge and understanding how hard it's going to be to win there, you know, then we're just not in the right headspace. And that's where I've got to make sure I've got our team focused and dialed in. They beat us there last year, right? And Ed can really coach. And like, that's a hard place to play. I mean, we've lost numerous games there, you know, and everybody knows you go into Citadel, like, it's going to be hard. It's going to be difficult. And they're not going to quit, you know, they're not going to quit. And I think even in the Mercer game, they're down 11 with 5:44 to go, and they won. You know, I mean, it was 60-49, and they came back and won the game. And so what you have to really understand is it's going to be a 40-minute battle. And those kids wake up at 5 a.m. every day or whatever it is, you know, and they, like, you sign up to go to Citadel, like, you're tough, right, and you're resilient, and you're going to be engaged, and it's going to be competitive. And so we have to go down there embracing a 40-minute fight, and we've got to go down there, and I mean, you're taking it back for granted in this league, you're going to get beat, you know, I mean, that's just the reality of it. on Saturday. Got to get back on track. We got to go down there and play with a good spirit, play with good energy, play connected, and you know, be ready for the challenge.
Coach, as far as the adaptations to get that buy-in, you know, year after year, new group of guys over the years you've been doing this. I work with Beth, and she was telling me about the ring that you wear. I don't know how long you've been doing that, but I'd imagine when you started coaching that that wasn't a thing, and the three ball advancement, you know, with people taking more threes. What are some of the biggest adaptations that you've gone through or added into your bag of coaching tricks over the years that you remember across this journey?
That's a good question. You know, the industry is ever changing, you know, and I think the biggest adaptations now, you know, you got NIL, you got portal, you got retention is becoming more challenging, right? And getting people to, you know, understand that, hey, listen, why are we doing all this? Okay. We want to put you on a path for excellence academically and post whatever you do basketball. Basketball and athletic excellence, so you can have a chance to go play for championships and have a chance to play in the future at a professional level if you would like to. And where we've always built this is, it's like a railroad track, right? Like, you have to have both of those two rails, right? Like, when you just get on one of those rails here, like, that train's tipping over, you know? Like, this isn't just a venture about, hey, let's go have a great basketball team. And I think right now, That's a little bit of the pull, right? Like, everybody can move around, right? And like, hey, I can go here, you know? And what can happen is it's like, how much do I really want to say, hey, this is my place. This is where I'm gonna go. This is where I'm gonna get my degree. This is gonna be a 40-year decision. And this is where I'm gonna bring my kids to. These are the memories. This is the locker room. These are my teammates. Like, we're losing that in college sport right now. And it's really sad, you know, because now all of a sudden, like, it's not so much how do we fix this. It's like, well, you know, not my responsibility, right? That's their responsibility, you know, or this isn't going well. So, hey, I'm gonna go here. Or, hey, you know, I'm going to try to use this to leverage myself here. And I think for us, we have to look back, and as we navigate, you know, the portal's here to stay, and there's some good in the portal. You know, I mean, Carter Witt is going to be an incredible story. Already is an incredible story how he's playing compared to how he was playing a year ago, right? Kylie Garrison was a great add for us 2 years ago. PJ Smith, you know, he's really come on here late, especially in finding people that, I guess, to say, how do you adapt? Like, to make sure that we understand that as much turbulence is going to be out there in the industry, winning is still going to be the same, right? And you can go study history, you can go study sport, you can go study military, you can go study business, whatever you want to study, right? You're going to see culture, you're going to see retention, you're going to see a way of doing it, you're going to see buy-in, and you're always going to see that it's bigger than a person, right? And it's about a group, right? It's about being a part of something that's bigger than yourself. So probably where I've had to adapt the most is like, we have to keep trying to find that as this thing kind of shifts away from that. And we have to double down and make a bet against history that we're all going to look back on this and say, oh, you know what? Yeah, this won then, and it always wins. And we have to stay true to it. And I think the beautiful thing about being in a place like Furman is it aligns, right? Like, that aligns. This place wants four-year students to graduate and go through freshman class to sophomore, and they all live together, and like, protecting that undergraduate model. And I want to be a part of that, right? I want to be a part of helping these players shape their lives to be great basketball players, to go play professionally, to win championships. But at the end of the day, like, in 20 years, they're looking back and they're saying, hey, coach, this place changed my life. And this program had a huge impact on my life. And that's why I do what I do. And I think the vehicle which we get there, you know, when I first started doing this, quite frankly, you know, 7 years ago, you know, you had to sit a year out, right? There was no money involved. You know, it was a lot more like steady state. And I think now we've got to continue to make sure that, hey, what this program has been built on will always be the foundation that we have to have it at. And, you know, I think that's probably been the biggest one. I think for me, you know, individually, probably just managing the stress of it, you know, just game day routine, you know, film routine, trusting my staff. Like, I'm 40, you know, like I've told myself a few times, like, I gotta get to 65 in this. I gotta figure out longevity here. You know, it felt great, you know, for years, everybody saying, well, man, you know, you're a young head coach. And now it's like, boy, I got 25 more years of this. Like, I've got to make sure I take care of myself. I gotta make sure I keep my priorities straight, my faith and my family, keep a balance. You know, my kids are gonna grow fast, they already are growing fast. So to figure out, probably the longer you do it, you figure out that balance a little bit better. Never perfect, but, you know, early in my career, I probably would just kind of go, you know, and still am that way a little bit, but trying to find pockets and trying to find ways to blend it. You know, I'm definitely, hopefully, my wife would agree, I've improved a little bit there.
Thank you, Coach. Just a reminder, Fum is back in action at the Citadel on Wednesday at 7 o'clock. You can watch on ESPN+. And listen on the Fan Upstate. Paladins are back home on Sunday at 2 o'clock, nationally televised game against UNC Greensboro on ESPNU. Tickets are still available at FumandPaladins.com. Thank you to Coach Richie and to Jeff Schatzel for producing today. Good day, everyone.